Welcome back, everyone, to the Insomnia True Server Championship. I'm Noxious, and with me, Nimsh and Raven. So the next match we've got is going to be Freaky versus Ness, a local, right?
Yeah, so Ness was it came second place at the last Insomnia event in summer. So, you know, doing pretty well. Until then, relatively unknown UK player. But again, yeah, second place. He's coming here to, and he got top 16. So he's made it this far, battled through the tournament yesterday. And yeah, he's going to see if he can push it even further and make a name for himself.
That's impressive, isn't it?
But I mean, it's his chance, right, to just make a splash. And he's going to be up against Freaky. We're going to be getting to the game shortly. They're actually ready to start.
Oh, wow. Freaky, you mentioned, he is also a very impressive player, even though he didn't win anything specific. I know he won some of the local tournaments, and even at DreamHack when he was playing side events before, he was able to snatch a couple of those. But he is really good with regards to qualifying. He qualified again for a very big major tournament, and in the past, he's also really good at ladder as well.
Yeah, well, he's here with a teammate, so at least there's some team spirit going on. He's got maybe somebody to support him in case things don't necessarily go the way he wants. That being said, I feel like overall there's too many players in the scene that haven't had a big championship, but that's largely due to the fact that there's only so many winning spots you can have, and the player pool has just increased drastically.
Yeah.
So it really, the wins of a tournament, like the tournament wins of a player don't necessarily reflect how good he is nowadays with the amount of them, so.
Yeah, and like you said, the player pool's constantly increasing. Everyone's also getting better at the game. So this time last year, even if there was the same size player pool, which isn't the case, like the difference in play overall, there's not any more. There's just like, you know, 10, 20, 30 good players. There's like hundreds of actual like top end players, but they just need their chance to just push through in a big tournament and take the win.
Also, I think like we are not paying that much attention to the top eights or enough attention because the winner, everybody knows who the winner is.
Right.
But then those guys consistently do top eight and they don't get enough credit for it.
That's right, because very often we only view the winner as being the relevant spot, but in truth, in a card game with the amount of variance that's involved, being top eight at all is a really big deal, especially through qualifiers. You know, the people who got here through the qualifier, for instance, are really deserving of a mention. And I think maybe in the future it would be nice to pay a bit of a tribute to the people who make it there.
Yeah, we see Ness there rocking the Christmas hat in full festive spirit.
Paladin,
oh, yeah. Happy
Secret Paladin.
Secret Paladin.
Merry Christmas.
Happy Feast of Winterveil.
wow, okay.
Such a trollish emote, right? Paladin versus Paladin, it seems.
Yeah, pretty crazy opener from both players. I guess you take the safe pick, whereby it's a class that curves well, and you're going to be doing fine against most of the field, no matter what it is. So in the last hero standing, if you can put that on your side right off the bat, that's a really big deal.
Yeah, and just as a quick note, it looks like the cameras are actually just quit the wrong way round on the stream. So we'll get right. That fixed, as Freaky's lineup is the Warrior Paladin Rogue versus Ness, who is on the bottom with the Druid Paladin Priest. So just going to get the cameras switched there just to put them in the right places.
The names are correct.
Yeah, the names are correct and the views are correct, but it's just the cameras there. That is not a Freaky on the top. And Ness in the SK clothing.
I also have like a small update from the background, because I was walking around when I was casting the last game, and apparently RDU lost to Super JJ 0-3.
Oh, really?
JJ won with Druid. So right now, RDU is hoping that in his group with AK Wonder JJ, he will have, and the board control, they will have a three-way tie, because that's his only way to actually advance for the second day.
Yeah, but it does look like now it's going to be Secret Paladin versus what appears to be mid-range with the Sylvanas and the Leon hands in hand there, we can see. The Secret Paladin has got the Secret Keeper down, and he's got a few options. He does have a Coin Muster if he really feels like it. He has a Juggler in or Mini Bot, and even working towards that Keeper of Alderman in a few turns' time.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that I was going to say, you mentioned the Coin Muster. The big issue with that play is very often that Keeper of Alderman may not come fast enough if Consecration shows up, because you're playing Coin Muster, Paladin has turn 3, and then he has the Consecration long before you get to play Keeper. So playing it slow is often the way you go. Usually, though, I think on paper, mid-range Paladin is supposed to be favored.
Versus Secret Paladin.
Right. Mid-range is supposed to be technically favored.
Secret Paladin can always do its thing and just curve and then drop down a Mysterious Challenger.
Yeah, so, when you have the curve.
It is Ness playing the mid-range and Freaky playing the Secret Paladin. Yeah, so he's going to muster just to match up Ness's muster now. So board looks pretty even. He can just chip off one, but then Ness can actually respond and do the same next turn. So we're probably going to see Keeper of Aldermans from both sides, I imagine.
Yeah, it's so cool. Like, there were so many good 4-drops in Paladin, and now Keeper is another one. How do you even manage all those 4-drops? Do you play one-offs of Consecration, True Silver, Keeper, Double Shredder? It's like 5 4-drops.
So instead of, so we used to have that problem where you have too many 4-drops. Instead of fixing it, they said, well, that's fine. Just like put more of them.
You can
and
choose
let them
now.
Choose exactly what they want to have.
I think in at least the Secret Paladin, the True Silver is the card that we've seen drop the most to play
right.
as a one of. As Consecrate is pretty good at just wrestling the board back, and then Shredders are Shredders, so then yeah. they ain't getting cut anytime soon.
And you get the Coghammers and Master for Battle, so you do have the weapons for 3 mana.
Yeah.
That's why weapon for 4 mana, even though it's a great card, True Silver Champion, especially if you play a True Silver Championship here at Insomnia.
Yeah, very, very relevant.
Yeah, absolutely. That's like the beyond the metagame.
Oh, so it looks like he's going to risk the juggle here just to try and get onto the 3-2.
I think the idea is if it hits the 3-2, I kill it now. If it hits the 3-4 and I can weaken it afterwards or it attacks into Noble Sack at some point, then I can guarantee a good Consecrate.
Do you think the Abusive Sergeant was worth it over just Hero Powering? Because although the Sergeant has the extra attack to maybe deal with these, like trade away these minions afterwards, it just seems like you've just thrown away a little bit of damage there, and he didn't actually get any of the juggles he wanted anyway.
I think I'd like attacking into the minion though. Even though you take 3 damage, you have a chance. The Noble Sacrifice Juggle will actually kill it. Unless there is a Consecration, but the Consecrate is bored. It doesn't look that threatening.
Right. And the funny thing about attacking the 3-2 is that if Ness decides to use his weapon to trigger the Noble Sack, if it kills the 3-1, you're far ahead. If he attacks with a 3-1, then that's okay too. So you end up clearing the board or trading yours for his. But the thing is, no matter how you look at this, Freaky is in a pretty bad spot compared to Ness.
Yeah,
because of the way the cards are lining up.
Absolutely. And also, Jessica Trueheart was going to bring a lot of dudes into the game, which might be hard to deal with.
Yeah, and I think that's something that's really key, actually. Playing against Secret Paladin, having enough minions on board for that turn 6, being able to proc the secrets and potentially answer the minions afterwards is pretty huge, and even just the extra 1-1s are going to be able to do that.
Oh man, Redemption is so bad. And this is one of the problems of Secret Paladin, and this is why the deck, I think, is balanced. Because even though it has this amazing curve that you can just win the game with, the secrets, you can show into them early, and then you just end up with this hand.
Yeah, I mean, do you think we kind of have to see a Hero Power Coin Keeper just to get something on the board? Because anything else just feels too slow.
I don't mind it. I mean, you're losing your board to that, though, because you're feeding everything into the Belcher. Like, the Belcher kills the... it attacks the 3-3, that is. And then the 3-1 and the weapon finish off your Keeper. So no matter what happens here, you're supposed to lose your board. But are you just banking on your ability to top deck the Mistress Challenger? Into,
of course, you're playing Secret Paladin. Is that not how you do it? Just do anything until turn 6 and then go?
Even Shredder is fine because you have Redemption. So it would still at least be somewhat justifiable.
The problem with the coin is that if you throw it right now, even though you might be forced to, if you get Dr. Boom, you will not be able to play it. So it's like something you can keep in mind.
Yeah.
Like if you get Tyrion, you'll be able to play Tyrion earlier. Yeah.
But I just think you need to do something.
Yeah,
right? I think that's the problem.
That.
If you just say, even if you just consecrated, well, the belt is still not dying anytime soon. So you really need to just challenge the board at least, and make your opponent trade into you here. And this looks like a really
quartermaster.
This is perfect for Ness.
Yeah, really safe turn to play Trueheart. Obviously, it sets up quartermaster as well, which is fantastic. But even without quartermaster, this is when you want to play Trueheart, when you're actually steady on board and you don't just play it on an empty board and try and claw back from there. You play it when you're ahead, and then you've got such an advantage going into the late game.
It's a 6-3. If it's not challenged, it still deals 6 damage.
Yeah, exactly. And Paladin doesn't really have anything other than like minion-based to do 3 damage as well, so even in the mirrors, they're going to be pretty strong, and those tokens are going to very, very quick.
Oh, that Tyrion, he might have been able to play if he'd only kept
the coin.
Because he could go, you know, Redemption now into Coin Tyrion.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, it's a giveaway. You know, it says, I have something that's not a 1-1 that I want to redeem, but at the same time, Ness can't do anything about that.
Yeah,
that's right. Well, that was the risk with the coin, and it seemed like he really has to do something. And, you know, he only had Tyrion and Dr. Boom in the deck, so
yeah,
most of the cards can...
Worst now is we've just seen Consecrate, and look at this next turn. Like, there is so little chance of Freaky having, like, an equality even in the deck. Like, how does he deal with this board? Like, it's just almost impossible at this point.
So what do we know about Ness? He is a local.
Yep, he likes mid-range decks. more than anything. I actually spoke to him briefly before the tournament, and I said, oh, so what's your lineup? He said, Priest, Druid, Paladin. I said, okay, reasonable. I said, oh, so Secret Paladin? And he's like, no, Midlane. I was like, oh, right, okay, because I'm more of the person where I think Secret Paladin's so strong, it's hard to take that over any or not take it over any other archetype within the class, but, you know, it, can't really argue with what's happening at the moment. The results are going his way.
It seems like it's a comfort pick.
Yeah.
I mean, it does beat Secret Paladin, so if you're expecting it out of everyone, then that's definitely something... it's a good call to make if you expect both of you to open with Pally, right? Because you always get the little edge on that matchup.
Yeah, and so many people open with Secret Paladin.
Right,
exactly. So, especially in Last Hero Standing, when the deck can quite easily 3-0.
It's a new Druid.
Yeah.
Basically,
yeah,
right. Yeah, that's exactly it.
And I don't even think Tyrion's going to be enough to save this game. He does have the redemption up.
Yeah, that's two. It eats two damage, right?
Yeah.
But with a consecration up in Ness's hand, nothing you do could ever stop this.
Yeah, it's over.
He's got death, like he's got him dead on board. But in case he needed anything more, then he has it.
So this means that Secret Paladin from Freaky is going to get eliminated. We are playing Last Hero Standing.
Yeah.
And then Ness is keeping his Midlane Paladin. I wonder if he's playing Murloc Knight, but seeing Sylvanas, maybe one.
Yeah, because there's got to be slots somewhere. But also, looking at Freaky's lineup, I am presuming we're going to see the Rogue next.
Yeah, absolutely. Rogue is a great counter. And Freaky was playing Rogue a lot before, even at Historic Cup, which was also Last Hero Standing. They did pretty well with it.
Do you think we're going to see the new Rogue card, the 5-4 Give a Coin?
It's funny because that card is one of the single most under-evaluated cards, I think, of the entire set. Where a lot of people were pretty spot on, I feel, with most of the cards that we saw. They had potential, but that's the cool thing about League of Explorers, is none of them is completely bonkers. They're all kind of playable, and they all shift the way you play a game. And I think that 4-mana 5-4, the Tomb Pillager, really does that as well. But Rogue hasn't had a card like this in forever.
Yeah.
Why is it good, though?
So people have been actually experimenting already with a return to Miracle Rogue-style gameplay, because the coin is so big, the body's decent, and then you follow up with the Gadget Zan. And, you know, any time you have, like, a coin effect or prep or anything like that, it opens up so many more options for the Rogue.
Imagine a mini prep.
Yeah.
Like, ask yourself, would I be happy if my Death Rattle said, gain a mini prep? You'd be like, yeah, I absolutely want to get that. And that is kind of how Rogues feel about it. And I think it helps them break the game in the way that Rogues do, which is ramp up and make crazy tempo plays at some point in the mid game. That's where everything has to kind of come together.
That is really interesting, but is it fitting the Oil Rogue, or is it just shouting like, hey, new Rogue archetype?
No, I think it fits Oil, honestly. I'm surprised actually that we saw
something.
There it is! I think
hold it.
Yeah, I think it fits Oil more than... Miracle is nice, but I think that's trying to bring back something that doesn't necessarily have to be brought back.
Yeah.
Whereas the card itself is good enough, in my mind, to be played in just standard lists.
Yeah, but now a really good response to the Juggler. This is what you fear playing against Rogue. Playing any minion like this, you just drop into coin, SI. And starting on the coin for Rogue is actually probably the more important than any other class.
Yeah,
I think getting the coin. And with the follow-up, he does have prep sprint for turn four, so he's playing against this mid-range Paladin, but he can actually keep up in card advantage, which is pretty huge. And the second the Rogue's got a full hand to play around with, it definitely gets scary. Yeah.
This matchup is so bad for Paladin, because Rogue has all the tools to like, keep the tempo, clear the board, and then when Tyrion comes up, just sap it.
Yep.
Yeah, you're like, turn 8, I'm safe. No, I know I'm not, because for 2 mana...
Gain another turn for 2 mana.
One thing to keep in mind, though, is that Freaky might be running, you know, the Oil Rogue. It looks so far like something standard that we see in Oil, but there's a possibility that he includes a Gadget Zan, because it used to be that Oil was trying to put them in. So there's definitely a chance that Gadget Zan makes its way to Oil because of the Tomb Pillager. I'm not saying it's guaranteed,
you need
but
it, though.
It makes sense.
Like, you might need it kind of like a sprint, but sprint might still be better.
You cut one sprint, you put one Gadget Zan, kind of like shuffle them around because suddenly you have the Tomb Pillager available.
Yeah, and also depending on what the meta's like, as you said earlier when people were doing that, the body's actually worth something from the Gadget Zan versus the sprint, which just draws. So. We do see the Murloc Knight, though.
Yeah, there is a frog. I'm happy, man.
Yeah, you did talk about this guy. Ooh, this may. Well, with the Tomb Pillager, it's all right. Now, the question is...
Are you okay committing, like, a lot, like, you one weapon charge to kill this?
It's tough, right? Murloc Backstab, Knight. Deadly Edwin, and then...
Yeah. I think you have to, though, because if you don't, then you... Well, he doesn't have Blade Flurry. So
you could just dagger up, but it kind of hurts, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I think you have to, again, like as you said with the rogue, you need that tempo. But he does have to deal with this, because if he doesn't and he's got no blade for it, then how's he going to deal with a board full of murlocs? If that summons another murloc knight,
full of murlocs.
There's a couple of cool things for Freaky. Not only he has the Edwin right now, there's no minion to challenge it. So even if there's equality, which there is,
good one,
it would have to be the weapon attack. But he has ways to refill his hand. He has a very good Azure Shake on 5, and he has preparation sprint as well.
Yep.
So this was worth the risk. Like, he's probably not happy to see the equality, but it wasn't the worst.
Well, you talk about expending resources, right?
Yeah, and also equality attack. So he still took 6, and then just hero power. So again, and you've got the opportunity to just continue to build that tempo and make the paladin deal with everything in really awkward ways.
That was double True Silver versus those Azdrakes.
And another equality as well. Yeah. So, you know, the True Silver's going to be good at clearing up. You probably would have liked to have seen a mini bot over that equality there, just to sneak something in a little bit better than a 1-1.
And also, Ness is slowly building up the board with those dudes, and the Quartermaster can provide some extra feedback there. But there is the Justicar True Heart, so maybe he will keep the Quartermaster for later.
Well, that's definitely a turn to play the Violet. Because the thing is, with the Tomb Pillager and the Azure Drake, you're dead to True Silver. You're just feeding them. And this is basically what has to be one of the best top decks, if not the best, that Freaky could have had here. Because it guarantees that his board lives unless there's a Consecration to complement this. Which means that suddenly your opponent has no turn 7. He just consecrates and plays a 1-1.
Although that draw is also important with the Keeper of Alderman there, making the Violet Teacher easily killed from the True Silver. And this
card.
Is why the Keeper of Alderman is so powerful. It's not like overpowered, but its flexibility is what makes it so good and why everyone's playing it in Paladin.
You know what we're missing? A 3-mana, 3-2 weapon for Paladins. Death Rattle, give a Silver Hand Recruit +2/+2.
Yeah.
And we need a Power Maze for those 1/1s.
But this is, again, another card from League of Explorers, and it only shows up how much influence this set has.
Yeah. I think, are we going to see Prep Fan here?
Actually, that wouldn't have been too bad.
Prep Fan would have cleared the board, and you've just seen True Silver, and you start the next turn with a Drake on paper.
I think preparation might be too valuable there. Like, you want to have preparation for the bigger turns, maybe.
So you want to do broken things
with like the oil prep. With flurry instead of like, hey, I just prepped Fan and drew a card.
You know, it's also worth noting that the Drakes and the Tomb Pillager together incentivize the Paladin to take face damage with the True Silver Champion. They see the trade, they have to take it up. Except unlike Warriors, they don't have that armor up button that they can recover the health from. So you are getting damage in without necessarily...
And then you just oil them
with
a combo later, which is much easier to do when they're hitting minions themselves.
And Ness is already at 17.
That is... And now this fan of knives is disgustingly good. Now you want to talk about doing broken things.
Double fan of knives, go. No, I think he wants to play the Tomb Pillager, right?
You want to see, first of all, what the first fan of knives gives, and then reevaluate.
I think you value SI to clear the board now.
Absolutely. You can even refresh your weapon here. Mm-hmm.
So are we even going to see Tomb Pillager hit the board this game?
We might not. I mean, this game is under Freaky's control fully.
At least we can say Tomb Pillager has 100%
win rate. Right?
Yeah. Like, never hit the board, but it's won every game it's been played in so far.
It's like elite
Starseeker. Oh, that's actually... It's like that. If Reno Jackson shows up as he never played in the first tournament, that would have been 100% win rate. It's just less fun than when Super JJ pulls it off at one health, right?
This reminds me of a tweet from Strifecrow. He tweeted that he accidentally hit Legend with a Face Hunter because he wanted to like test the camel. He never got the camel, but
oh no.
He just drew on curve.
This is so sad.
Prep Sprint's going to be pretty good here. He can follow up with Fan of Knives if he's really scared of those 1-1s. I mean, he did see the Quartermasters in the last game.
Ah,
so
better yet. He
is aware of it.
Up,
and another prep and oil.
You have to do it. Tomb Pillager, Prep, Fan of Knives, right?
Do a Pillager high! Yay! Hit the board. Okay, we're good.
He doesn't want a Phantom Knives. He wants to force one Quartermaster on this, and so it doesn't trade 2/3/3s for the 5/4. But
this turn is pretty good.
Yeah, and if those knives all miss, then Freaky is in a good spot, but it's very unlikely. All right, at least he gets a good Blade Flurry.
Yeah.
Is there any chance he has?
Yeah, exactly.
Lethal?
Right. It might be close to lethal.
So it's gonna be armor up. Oh, two Tomb Pillagers. Okay, so he runs two. That's interesting. So he has the.
Is he not playing Shredders then?
I don't think so.
No, I think that's what you have to cut, right?
Right. That I think that's
the only
what,
space in the
right.
deck.
You can't cut teachers just because they're teachers.
Yeah. That might make sense because there's now a lot of tools to actually deal with the Shredder, with deadly poisons, bashes.
And the thing is, in that deck, the Shredder was only used as a tempo tool. And what the inclusion or the replacement makes is it turns the tempo play into more of a combo deck, right? You yeah. add the combo element, you remove some tempo, because the Shredder itself was never valuable as a Shredder.
Such a good turn, the Thalnos making the blade very perfect to actually fully play the board, put so much pressure, but let's be honest, this was going to be a rough matchup for the Paladin from day one.
Yeah, it only shows what you just said. It's super tough. Like, there is no even Tyrion to pull out.
Oh, that's game, right?
It's over, yeah.
That's it? We see Tresor Champion can heal him up to 6, but right back to 0 he goes.
Yeah, and the problem here is as well, so Ness has either Druid, which we can guess is mid-range, it might be Aggro Druid, I don't know, and then Priest, which is almost certainly going to be a variant of a control-style deck. Like, none of those... Do you think the Druid lines up well against the Rogue?
No, I think that's a fair point.
And the Priest definitely doesn't
Rogue,
line up well versus
Rogue
the Rogue.
Is an amazing choice for this tournament, for the group stages,
yep.
and for this metagame, but not everybody can play Rogue.
Yeah. Definitely good for the Rogue players of old to come back, because as you said, there are so many decks that people are playing that Rogue actually demolishes, so really good sort of pocket pick there for these guys who have took it, and as you said, can play it.
And Tomb!
Yep.
Yeah!
That's a surprisingly good card.
Yeah. I love the golden animation. This is the normal
it's
one?
It's actually really cool, right?
Yeah.
In the Chinese Star Ladder, one of the guys who got, he might have actually qualified, was playing in Tomb Priest. And it might have been Zetalot's list, where it maxes out at 6. At 6 mana. This is the Justicar and the Entombs. And the rest of the deck is just not dying, and you just wait and wait and wait. But
oh, Museum Curator here for Ness.
Coin it out. We want to see what that death rattle is now. Coin it out, Ness, if you can hear me, which you most definitely cannot.
Interesting. So this is, a very bad matchup. Like, with Druid, it's questionable. It might be closer to 50-50, yeah. but Rogue versus Priest, especially versus Country Priest, originally was always very good. There was, like, Rogues can just go to, like, 8 points of health, yeah. 10 points of health, and still win.
An interesting pick, though, because would you not prefer Priest versus, say, if it was Patron Warrior from Freaky? Because this kind of Priest with, like, I'm guessing double Light Bombs, Holy Nova, etc. With the Arcanine Soul Priest, you guess he's got Circle?
That's a good card, though.
Yeah.
So the Circle of Healing, the list that Zetalot you're talking about yeah. does run the Circle.
Yeah.
But there are Entomb lists that do not. Okay. Right. There have been some. They're usually a little less consistent because they end up going overboard on control cards.
Yeah.
So maybe he is targeting more aggro decks than Patron with this Priest list. Mm-hmm. That's why he wants to win with the Rogue.
Yeah.
Maybe he doesn't have that much experience with the Rogue. Like, I don't know much about Ness.
I don't personally know how long he's been even playing the game for. He's only really propped up in the past sort of 4 or 5 months, at least on my radar. So I've no knowledge about that.
Well, he's playing really well. He's playing correctly, but how much knowledge he has about this specific matchup?
Yeah.
Right? Like, Rogue is not that popular on the ladder, I believe, right now.
And he does have it. Is that second Curator in hand? It is.
It is, yes.
Play it. I just want to see more death rattle.
I think with a Shredder, it's hard to pass up the opportunity to play on curve. I mean, if the Rogue has an AoE, then so be it. At least you have the Wild Power to recoup some of this board if things go wrong. So I'd probably just go for the tempo play here.
Yeah.
Play the Rogue's game.
Yeah, because the problem is, at the end of the day, although Curator can get you some amazing cards, it's still a 1-2. It's not going to do much on the board. It survived a dagger attack now, but it's still not going to put too much power there if you play that and say, like, heal up or something.
Yeah. It's like Novice Engineer. When you used to play it back in the days, it was always better on turn 8 or, very late. You just weave it in as an extra hero power, that draws you a card.
That's like 2 years ago, actually.
Yeah, but that's kind of how I used to see play.
Yeah, you did.
And you literally cannot...
Because it is like Novice
Circle.
It's a 1-2.
It's the same thing, yeah. Oh.
So Ness is actually going for the draws. So he's valuing having better cards for the future more than just having...
Would you have circled there to draw 3 more cards? Would that have overdrawn him?
2 more cards? Oh, 3 more cards, yeah.
So it would have gave him 10 cards, so that's his coin. Okay. It's just sometimes, yes, the teacher's there, but the teacher's still on the board at 3 health. And with the Nosheite Cleric down, that would have drawn a lot of cards for him.
I mean, the worst case scenario is Deadly Poison, Attack, Blade Flurry. But then, if that's the case, then he has to attack with the teacher to finish off the Death Lord, in which case the Nova clears everything.
Yeah.
So you're still in an okay spot.
That's a really good turn for Freaky.
Is it good enough? Because everything dies to Nova still.
I suppose the benefit is Freaky has a good follow-up. Nova this turn clears the board, leaves the Chow on there. But then, you know, he's got the Drakes, he's got it. If he can pull something to weave the SI agent in to kill off the Chow with the attack.
The backstab would be pretty good here.
Yeah. Okay.
Do you even need it?
No, you don't. You absolutely don't. But it just lets your like your current hand with backstab is exponentially
better. Yeah, Arcanine Circle's a thing.
All right, so backstab wasn't that bad, actually, because right now we were taking 5 more damage.
Well, you didn't need to use it now, but you really wanted backstab in this hand.
Is this potentially going to be Drake's sap?
Eviscerate's better in this case.
Yeah,
Eviscerate.
What if you just push face? Because you can't heal.
Yeah, that's how you do it, right?
If you had a South Sea deck hand, you might consider it.
That is a trap, I think.
Yeah, I know. Absolutely.
Oh, Harrison Jones is there.
Whoa.
Do you even need more cards, though?
No.
Yeah, and you probably want to hit with Harrison a weapon that's actually buffed, not just a...
Is this... like just the Shredder Deathlord turn?
I don't mind that at all.
I just think like, cause like Soul Priest Circle, yeah, you kill the 4-4, but now your Soul Priest is 3-1. And then you can't really, and then slow up like Curator maybe? I don't know. I just think Shredder Deathlord feels too good to pass up.
The good thing about Shredder Deathlord is that when they get something from the Deathlord, you will have that Soul Priest Circle combo.
Well, Harrison Coin Deathlord isn't half bad either. As weird as
That's true.
Because you are forcing him to waste 2 mana more on resetting his turn. But in that case, what you're doing is you're buying time. And yeah. I don't know if that's what you're trying to do.
I just think you're worried about Blade Flurry if you do that. Because with the Rogue having so many cards in hand, and the Drake for spell damage.
Oh man, this Shredder is so obscene. So obscene.
It's pretty good there.
All right. Hey, wait. There could be a Shredder in a Curator. And a Curator and a Shredder.
Yes, not possible.
This is...
mind blown.
Yeah. Shredderception.
Shredderception.
This doesn't make sense.
It's like the web spinners giving me raptors that are giving me web spinners.
Game of goats.
It's all right. Sneasel Shredder gives Sneasel Shredders.
Okay, so what? He's on quite low health. I mean, Priest isn't really known for burst, but...
I don't hate the idea of turning on the aggression. The problem is you do have to kill that Deathlord because it comes back and, like, sapping it again doesn't make sense unless you deal with Shredder right now and are guaranteed not to get Light Bomb.
Well, I suppose he could sap Oil and then push for damage. Then he has Blade Flurry next turn. He has Blade Flurry this next turn.
What about just slamming Boom on board? Just Dr. Boom, it's green.
Right.
Yeah, but then that Light Bomb absolutely wrecks
you. No, that's the thing. You have to guarantee the Light Bomb's not going to hit you right now. If you get hit by Light Bomb...
yeah, you're in trouble.
You're in trouble. So you have to kill the Death Lord before things go worse than they are. The spell damage is super important here as well.
All right, so it makes sense that he's getting another minion. But there is Arcanine Circle coming.
Yeah.
Oh, and the SI, so that's definitely all going to get cleared up. And the Priest is still a good spot.
Yeah.
And there's also still Entombs in the deck. Oh, Velen's Chosen. That's not something we've seen too often in the Entomb Priest.
Truly. I thought it was pretty much an auto-include in most Priest lists. I mean, it is not... like, it does have minions in it, right? It's not this kind of minion-centric approach. And when you're playing Curator...
I think with Curator, it's obviously a lot better because it's another 2-drop. It's similar to Dragon Priest. You have so many low minions that you can go turn 2, a minion, turn 3, Velens.
Oh, man. And another Death Rattle card. What is it this time?
Was that a bit awkward with the sequence in there? Did he not want to see what the mech was first?
I don't think... no matter what you get from this Death Rattle, I think there was not a single one...
It'll be better than Velen's in the Soul Priest. Shredder! Well, okay! I'm just going to play with 2 Shredders in my deck as well. Why not?
I think I'm about to put Curators everywhere.
it looks
if
good,
the card reads Sky Draw Golems, a Shredder.
Cairn, Sylvanas, Shredders.
A lot of great defense.
Even Harvest Golems are good.
Maybe you should play Undertakers as well.
Might as well.
Tugan, that's it.
Oh no, the comeback. Tugan and Stalag.
Even the Cultist. To go into turn 3, Dark Cultist from Priest.
No, it's amazing.
It's pretty good.
Yeah.
There's
Speaking
Sylvanas.
Of Sylvanas.
Well, you do have to ping that Dr. Boom, so. Is Harrison Jones something you do here because you want to avoid the board getting worse?
How much mana does he have? 7 after his so
you don't play Wildpyro, or maybe find.
I like injured and Shredder, I guess.
Yeah, the only problem here is, again, like, if you do Harrison, then you lock out two more mana for the Rogue next turn to do anything crazy with, which is worth something in itself. The card draw is going to be nice, but making the Rogue, like, re-hero power is pretty nice as well.
Yeah, but this is important at stage.
Maybe you should use it for Lothab, right? Like, as a Lothab, where you lock him down, then you win.
Also, like, Harrison is great if you have some kind of ward and they get a big weapon and they just keep the weapon to threaten you and just slam the weapon with Harrison.
Right. Like, oh, Blade Flurry threat? Yeah, keep that for yourself.
Yeah.
That's a prep.
I like this turn.
That's really scary. So prep sprint Edwin gives you a 6-6, which is not...
What about Violet Teacher prep? Violet Teacher prep oil? Edwin, that fits, right?
I don't like the oil when you've just played the teacher. It's not reliable. It'll go on 1/1s, and then you pretty much waste it. But if you're going to oil, I think it's going to be next turn when you're about to win. Oh. See, if he played prep, that would have been a mistake.
Oh, is he doing Blade Flurry?
Probably, in this case.
And he hit the correct minion, so he will be able to attack as well.
Yeah. See, if he played prep, he would have been much less likely to hit. What do you want?
Yeah.
The obligatory well played from the priest.
So do you hit into the Shredder? Yeah, you hit into the Shredder where you face them,
and
played prep. Because you might keep hold of the fall one instead.
Absolutely. And you hope that this is actually something you can kill.
It has to be, right?
There's no, well, Anoyotron can kind of...
Oh, true. All right, Nick.
Wow, that's a great point.
Yeah.
I mean, you still do get the Boombot damage and Death Rattle to the
face,
but it's not as satisfying.
Oh my god, the Boombot can't be Cabaled.
What?
Changes everything.
And there's no spell for that Wild Pyromancer. Could this be the beginning of the end?
Yeah, this looks grim for the priest.
Yeah, so it's 10 damage from the Rogue with Hero Power, just on the board and available. But with Prep Sprint, you know, have we seen both Eviscerates?
Yeah, we have.
And we've seen both SIs. What's
so there's
left
only
in the deck?
Maybe Deadlies.
Another oil.
I think a lot of lists only run the one now, but it's possible that he runs two. And in that case, this would change things up.
I like Sylvanas. He is trying to have a spell next turn with Pyromancer and have a good Sylvanas kill.
And now this kind of puts off the whole just playing a big Edwin here.
You gotta go all in on damage here if you're the Rogue.
Oh man, if Ness actually picks up a spell, and if this is Edwin, like, do you even play Edwin versus Sylvanas, seriously?
Do you want to Lothab, because that just locks Light Bomb out and just go face?
Lothab looks good.
You could prep sprint again. Because why not?
I don't know if...
you absolutely don't have to, but you could.
The Sylvanas goes into Lothab, but the odds on it stealing something else are huge.
I like killing Sylvanas this turn, because you still have those minions, and you know Priest has a lot of removal. Like, you can expect Pyromancer, you can expect a Holy Nova, and then you're just going to lose what you have. And right now he can kill Sylvanas on his terms.
And be able to respond to it if things go really, really badly.
That was close, right?
Well, Lothab will be locking out the Light Bomb possibility, which means that if Ness wants to live, he's going to have to do it with a Shredder and a really cheap spell.
Oh man, so
if
close.
If only.
Well, Hail Mary.
He can steal a dude. And then I guess, well...
You gotta go Hail Mary on the...
Shredder.
On the Shredder here.
So get that Anoyotron.
You attack Lothab, and you hope you find...
Frostwolf Grunt.
Bluegill Warrior. Even Bluegill is good, right? Like, it helps you out.
What if it's Curator and he can't do anything?
Oh no.
I think it's crazy that the Wild Pyromancer bit's been in hand pretty much all game, and he's just never found a moment.
Well, whoa! It's something, but it's not helping.
I was going to say, that's game. If only it had charge.
Oh man, this Rogue is so good versus lineup. So Ness is only with his Druid now. And Druid versus Rogue, we've mentioned that Rogue is so good versus Druid. Is there anything specific that makes this matchup better for Druid or no?
Yeah, get the backstab for the Aspirant or the Deadly Poison, and you're good. And if you don't, you might as well not play the game. If it comes out early and you don't have the answer, I feel like things snowball out of control way too quickly, unless you have your own prep, you know, completely insane plays.
How does the Pillager change the matchup?
It actually forces it lets the Shredder trade very, very well. And it also, unfortunately for you, as a Druid, gives you it forces you to play the swipe on it, which makes the teacher even more annoying later on.
Yeah,
I like this keep from Freaky, though. He kept the prep into sprint, which a bit unfortunate now he's drawn another sprint, but as the rogue, you need the answers to anything like early, as you said, like to the aspirant. So if the aspirant does come down and then he builds up the board quickly, at least he can maybe prep sprint to draw those answers quickly, either the sap or the big blade flurries a bit later in the game.
Yeah, this is pretty, it's a pretty good turn. It doesn't look very good because he doesn't kill it now, but because he's got the prep and the eviscerate together, he can go for something fancy next turn and kill whatever comes out.
Like prep, eviscerate, SA7.
Right.
And weapon attack as well. The problem is we're going to see the Paralyzed Shredder from Ness.
It's only got a curator in it. Or another aspirant.
Oh no. The joys.
Is there a 2-mana explorer? No, not really. Okay.
No, hey, what?
A 2-mana explorer.
Oh no, we have Bran at 3, Elise at 4.
And 1-mana Finley. Yeah.
I'm surprised they didn't bother going all the way, right? Like, the 2 and a 5, we have none right now.
Yeah.
So. Come on, Blizzard. Sort it out.
I mean, no matter what, Ness is going to get a turn 5, a turn 3, innervate, drill the claw if he wants to. So even though the board might be handled by Freaky, I think he's still going to be fine.
Yeah, the game is quite even still.
Yeah, definitely.
Even though Freaky has a lot of great cards, but using this preparation now it will mean that sprint will only come later in the game.
Yeah, but I mean, ultimately, you didn't necessarily expect the second sprint. Oh, that's a great outcome.
Yeah.
It is, but I think I would like actually attacking first into the 2-1, the 2-3, because this could have been an Oyotron, and then you don't deal with aspirant, or like Frozen Grunt, or...
It could have even been Mana Wraith, for all you know. Not Nerubar Weblord, because this is not a Battlecry.
Yeah.
Combo is not the same thing as a Battlecry, but it is. It would have stopped him, for sure.
Yeah, I like the follow-up with the Keeper as well, just to clear up there. Pretty nice. It's not like there's a lot of silence targets against Rogue. Obviously, Van Cleef is a problem, and if something's oiled, then yeah. But there's Druid has other ways to deal with that, so...
Yeah, I like...
with the BGH in hand as
I
well.
I also like not spending Innervate, because on turn 5, you could have got, like, Ancient Floor, maybe Dr. Boom that you wanted to play. And the Innervate will be just really good later in the game if you get to combo parts.
Yeah, and Lotheb from Ness means that he does have a turn where... he can pretty much lock out the rogue from doing anything too dangerous, because the rogue relies on the spells quite heavily to make the big impact plays.
Probably turn 7. Nice. Just
yeah.
Sprint.
Yeah.
Okay, so there's Falnos from Freaky, and he is building up some board. But right now, looking at his hand, a double sprint.
He's desperately. I mean, he's not playing Gadda's hand, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Now we know for a fact that I don't think the Tomb Pillager. Well. It might be there, but with all the cards we've seen,
surprising.
I would be surprised to see 2 sprints and a get a 10. So it does mean that the Tomb Pillager may not have affected his deck building that much.
Yeah, just swap them to check out the work. I like how the map is actually changed into snowy, happy winter.
Happy feast! I hate, you know, I thought the emote was super fun the first time, and then I realized my priest sounds like Rexxar when he says, you know, anything.
Yeah.
He sounds so, like, it offends me how my Anduin sounds.
I used it for the first time when I was playing against Shaman. I had double for Reaver on board and a happy feast of Winter's Veil.
You're about to get a really painful gift. Oh, feels good.
I'm just always well played, happy feast of Winter's Veil when I win.
All right, so very awkward turn for Freaky, but ultimately what he's looking to get here is a way to AoE down the board next turn with the Deadly Poison Flurry. Unfortunately, Ness with the Lotheb is going to lock out the ability for Freaky to wipe it, and if a Savage Roar were picked up in a case like this, that would basically mean that over, you know, one more turn, the game's over.
Yeah. You might even think about, do you innervate the Beacon Hunter as well? Just to, because
I would actually do it. If I go Lotheb, I innervate BGH every day.
Yeah, because what's actually going to happen?
Yeah.
Like, what's the worst? You've seen Thanos as well, so it's not like he could. Yeah, he couldn't even fit it in with Flurry either.
And you set up Lethal this way as well.
Exactly. Yeah. It's hard to say no to a play like this. It backfires in what case? There's a heal bot, and even then, it's like a matter of time before you get to pull the trigger.
Yeah, you almost just reset the following turn again, don't you? He's come with the Thorsen, though.
He still gets a decent Lotheb turn on the follow-up. The only issue is now Freaky can react easily by just wiping the board completely.
Yeah, it's kind of weird there, because if you, surely it's 16 health for this kind of board. If you can lock them out one turn, as we said, you get so much impact. Even if you decided not to innovate the big game Hunter and just play the Lotheb to gain like the push turn, that still would have been reasonable. Whereas, as you said, and Thorsen, what's it actually reducing?
Well, it's helping you get the Lotheb for a cheaper, you know, amount next turn. I mean, another time. The only issue is, with a hand as big as that of Freakus, you know, there's possibly AoE tools in there. There might be an oil, there might be flurries. You've seen two Phantoms of Knives earlier. You're maybe feeding into that.
Yeah, well, you can safely assume there's a lot of spells. But apparently he wants to have Lotheb for a different turn, and he maybe felt like he wants... I don't know.
The benefit here for Ness, though, is that it does take up both durability off the weapon to be able to Blade Flurry that down. So, you know, he's not getting the optimum amount of damage he could do. And, yeah, I guess we're definitely following up with Lotheb now.
Well, you have to play something.
Yeah.
And you can't draw a card with Wild Growth.
If you innovate, can you draw a card with Wild Growth? Does that work?
No, that doesn't work.
You know, the Phantom of
Knives... Many players tried it,
though. We didn't mention it, but the Phantom of Knives was a bit of an interesting decision because he could have played the SI to damage the Druid of the Claw for two and then Flurry. Like, go Deadly Poison, SI, re-Deadly Flurry.
Yeah,
and then you have a
3-3
on the board. I'm not sure how much that's worth when you haven't seen Wrath. But maybe that would have given him a bit more breathing room going forward.
Yeah, Ness has still got one more turn before that Wild Growth can draw him another card and cycle.
Also, he actually refused to innervate Big Game Hunter again.
Yeah, he opts to keep the BGH for the Dr. Boom. He knows there's a Dr. Boom in Freakus' deck.
Yeah. All right, so that's 7 damage. He needs 7 more. Savage Roar is making it. Yep, so that's it.
That'll do it.
I called the card again.
Pretty good.
Easy.
It's the Caster Curse.
It is.
The Nimsh Curse.
You're looking for those cards all the time. Ness was looking for a card and he got it.
Okay, so this is going to the last game.
And it's a really good one because we have the Warrior left from Freakus. I want to see what it is. But again, Druid Warriors have a really interesting dynamic right now. Even Patrons, right? Patrons being around, for some reason, it kind of fell in popularity
for a long
time.
At least Starseeker Patron?
Yep.
At least Starseeker Patron.
Freakus confirmed playing Kranich's list.
Well, why not?
It would be so good.
Manage SK Gaming confirmed.
Guys, I would not be satisfied if we don't see a Golden Monkey in this tournament.
Well, I can tell you right now, there is a Core Chronolite in the deck that Freakus is running, and if Kranich and him were talking to one another, maybe.
So what does Corcron tell us?
Oh, never mind.
No, this is...
That can't be at least Starseeker, right? Well, who knows?
Possibly. Maybe it's a new warrior. It's Freaky Corcoran Warrior.
Maybe it's Freaky Warrior. Oh, the Innervate and the coin for Ness as an opener. Very good.
So Freaky is missing a free drop. He has Fireworks, though, which is pretty good. But we don't exactly know what he's playing.
Oh, Fireworks is really good now that there's an aspirant in the hand of Ness.
Do you just play the Shade on Innervate? Maybe? Because you don't have a turn 4 unless you coin. So maybe get the Shade out and then Aspirant on...
Yeah, that's fine. It's more guaranteed. Because if you just play the Aspirant and hope you get the Crystal, it gets weaponed down, and as you said, it's you're sort of in the same situation, but you're a little bit further behind.
You can actually coin the Druid of the Claw there, right? Because if you play Aspirant, you will have 4 mana.
Technically, you could have, yeah. If there's no weapon, you're in a good spot. But you really have to get lucky on that front.
You always play as if the Warrior's got the Fiery War Axe. Because they seem to always have...
Sometimes you can risk it, but in this case, Freaky has it, and he's going to kill it. This means 4 mana only.
You know, I'm wondering, what if he didn't pick up the Armorsmith? Would he have armored up or played the axe? What? I would have probably armored up, just to bluff.
You can probably armor up.
But it's interesting to figure out.
Well, you have no turn 3 play anyway,
yeah,
right?
Exactly.
If you have the turn 3 play, then yeah, you play the axe just for mana efficiency and to get it equipped. But yeah, without turn 3, you did just choose to do that. The Whirlwind... I mean, Shred is okay. Turn 4, right?
It's not pretty okay,
yeah. It's normally a good play.
How do you guys like this Corcoran and Leiden Patron? Because this is Patron. Like, after seeing those many cards, we know at this point.
I think it's actually pretty useful because Patron, like post-nerf, can't really do any on-demand damage. Whereas Corcoran, it's not tons, but being able to just do an extra 4 and 8 with both, of course, to just push for a bit more, just a tiny bit, because there's only Grom that's really like the instant win condition in the deck. And if the Patrons get cleared up, you need something. And a 4-3 is actually reasonably difficult to deal with. It needs an answer. Yeah.
And you have Inner Rages, and you have maybe one Taskmaster. So it's also another card that can actually charge.
No, I feel like the Corcoran is a card that wasn't really having a good reason to exist as long as the Frothing Berserker could charge. But yeah. Now that it can't, suddenly the Corcoran gets a little bit of value.
I remember Corcoran being playable in Contra Warrior at some point.
Yeah.
KitKat was playing it to counter...
Kuyuki, was it? Who ended up popularizing it? I think it was Kuyuki.
Kuyuki or KitKat?
KitKat, I know, was playing Warrior back then, but somebody made a Warrior list that included it.
I think that was KitKat. It was like Azure Drake, Corcoran.
Right, that's the one. That was the one. Yeah. It's an interesting card because it's not bad. Sometimes it just doesn't feel good enough.
Is Freaky not going to run the Shredder in and kill the Druid here? Okay.
Well, the end is coming.
Doomsayer, you say? No.
Oh! Finally, old
he
friend!
He was there, inside!
That belongs in a museum.
Oh, man.
Called it.
So he is summoning Shredders, and then he's hiding inside of them.
Yeah. You know, museum creator should have a battle cry, destroy Harrison Jones. Right? He just
like,
battle cry,
Jones
destroy Harrison Jones, and it really just says, "You're not curator," and he just kills him straight up.
He's taking care of all the Doomhammers that Harrison Jones destroyed, right?
And that's pretty much what he does. You know what's funny though is what if there's a special interaction that we just never saw between these guys?
Yeah, possibly.
I would love to see that, but Blizzard, please.
When do you think Ness has to reveal the shade?
When it kills.
You think you hold on to it for that long?
At 20 health right now, if I'm at 20 health, I mean, my opponent has 20 health or so.
Just because you've got four more turns to potentially wait for the combo, right?
I mean, he can't reveal... He can do it now if he wants to, but he knows he's going to die. So the question is, how desperate are you to clear? Because that's at this point, that's the indicator.
So there's 14 damage on board now.
And you're not afraid of Grommash yet because next turn is turn 7?
Probably because if you can do 14, well, take the weapon away. So if you do 10 damage now, then suddenly you're on 11 health, and then you are very afraid of Grom.
If you play the Shades, you're forcing him to have Execute. If you reveal it, but at the same time, you know, Drill the Cloud to protect the Shade doesn't do much. So, yeah, exactly. I mean, you have to charge with it because you don't protect it at all.
Yeah, and you need to kill Armorsmith as well because there is a Wurmt effect. So if Armorsmith stays on board, it's going to provide so much armor to Freaky.
Especially if this turn was, like, the Patron turn. If he has Patron in a Rage this turn, then suddenly you're in massive trouble.
Absolutely. There isn't that Armorsmith. He still has the Execute. He has a great way to deal with this board here. It's so funny, like, he doesn't need Patrons. I mean, Patron will help a lot, and he will just win the game there. But
Patron's kind of the... Oh, wait, is there another deck that has this secondary win condition? Because that's sometimes how this feels. It's supposed to be primary, but these days I feel like the weapons do a lot more work.
It's like Maligos Warlock. The win condition, officially is the Maligos Burst, but a lot of the time you just beat them because you have big
dragon
minions.
That's exactly what Patron
combo
feels like.
Combo Druid. Like, you don't have a combo, but sometimes you win with the minions.
Sometimes you just have Savage Roar. It's like
should be like Savage Roar Druid.
I just want to see anything can happen.
Yeah.
It's a great deck. Oh, it's a
great win condition as well.
It will be great one day.
Yeah, I think it will be really. I think it's similar to Patron, right? At first, the Patron lists weren't fantastic, but then, like, a little bit later down the line, when people really started to work it out, the deck improved massively.
You still need to explore the deck. I feel it's similar to Freeze Mage because there is this win condition that you have to stall to really actually execute.
Yeah, but you don't have Ice Blocks, so there's no. I think that's the really big drawback with the deck itself.
Yeah, because if you don't draw, say, the Healbot or the Lay on Hands, then, like, what do you do? You don't normally run too many taunts either.
So we saw Freekill, you know, a few turns ago. He opted not to attack the Shade directly and use his weapon to clear. Instead, he opted for the Execute plays. That means that overall he didn't really feel like taking an extra 7, knowing that there's a possibility Ness is holding combo.
Guys, is it Tempo BGH?
Surely not.
It has to be.
Oh my god.
He needs to stop valuing this card.
he's keeping it for Dr. Boom, come on.
Yeah, Grom, Dr. Boom.
Or Big Frothing Berserk.
Yeah.
To be fair, Frothing and Ghoul seems okay. At this point, what else can Freaky do? I mean, he can hold off if he wants to, but Battle I just think Frothing Ghoul seems nice.
Yeah, absolutely. Frothing Ghoul here, but he needs to pick up Battle Rage and draw more cards.
Is he going to skip the Ghoul?
you might want to have the ghoul when you pick up a patron.
Yeah, he's seen swipe, right? So maybe he's a less fearful of the swipe at the trade-in for the aspirant.
The ghoul doesn't do that much on this board. Keeper is interesting. You can easily kill the 2-4. Like, actually, what Ness can do is just play Shredder, attack the 2-4 with the 2-3, and then just kill it.
Sure. That sounds like the most straightforward play. Oh, that's a...
Savage roll. So what's he... Oh, Hero Power and Shredder to clear.
He really wants to avoid any shenanigans with a massive amount of Whirlwinds and Patrons.
That's... That was correct, because he didn't want his...
He wants to keep the aspirant alive. So that
it
wasn't
seems like,
misplay.
Whoops, yeah, he's like, getting one more armor. Acolyte is interesting.
Yeah, you go Ghoul, Acolyte, Whirlwind, Battle Rage, if you get lucky.
I think it's is he just doing...
You can Whirlwind first.
Yeah, that's fine.
Like, the thing is that you cannot just not Whirlwind here, because there is a possibility to keep early growth.
Are we going to see another Curator?
Yes!
Here we go!
Go for it, Curator, Origin Fair.
Aww. That's pretty bad.
You can Keeper it with your Keeper and then attack 5 to face.
Yeah.
The plays.
Well, actually, this is not bad as well, because it's still like 5 attacks.
Just on the, like, it's on the cusp of being easily manageable, but 5 damage is more than the warrior wants to take, although he will have to.
Well, he's still at 26, so it's not terrible. 25 now.
Yeah. And we know there's no combo in Ness's hand. Freaky doesn't know that. But we know that.
There is Dr. Boom.
Dr. Boom Ghoul? Feels okay now, right?
So, the interesting thing, I mean, you want to play that. The thing is the Boom Bots then blow up.
Yeah, because if you Dr. Boom Ghoul, you don't have to really worry about the Berserker, right?
It's just that you're feeding him a way to kill your Boom Bots.
Can you just like play Dr. Boom and kill the Berserker with weapon?
Right, kill the Berserker,
armor up?
Yeah.
Dr. Boom armor up.
Yeah, it's just free damage.
Yeah.
And you're at 23, so it's not bad. You're not dead to combo yet. Combo is like 21.
Feels bad to take 5.
Yeah, you're like at 22 health, you're one off of death. And with Emperor having triggered, technically you'd be dead if he's holding it.
Well, you still have to.
So you have to play the Ghoul if you expect combo. So I guess Dr. Boom Ghoul was the play.
Do you? Yeah, because combo is like 22, right?
Yeah, it kills you.
Yeah. Because also the Ghoul, the Boom Bots going off, actually can kill the combo pieces, so it just locks it out completely.
Mm-hmm. There's no combo though, double wild growth, so there might be something.
It's still drawing.
Double. I mean, honestly, the draw plus BGH is perfect in that it lets him get the BGH out.
Yeah.
I mean, the draw out without worrying about dying. So it keeps him safe for the time being. And he can even go with the BGH on the back of this. I mean, the Keeper of the Grove to remove the Ghoul if he wants.
I would love to keep my Torison if possible.
Yeah.
If there is a chance. And
would you just silence the Ghoul?
Yeah, I'd do that.
Yeah, I think it's fine. And just go face with Torison.
Oh! Hang on.
So weird.
Hang on a minute.
You can't play, you still need to play Bigger Hunter.
Do you?
Yeah.
I suppose there's a few outs.
Like Grommash Taskmaster kills you.
Yeah, that's true. Depending on where the Boombots go, Grommash Taskmaster might kill you anyway.
That's true, actually. We've seen those amazing Boombots from Amaz.
He's silencing Boombots. You know, that kind of works, though. I like that even better than what we
talked
about.
And there's another minion to soak up, but 3.
Whoa.
This means he's not dead to Grommash Taskmaster. Yeah.
Not by much, though, but...
Not one damage.
Dead.
Can he win next turn, though? It's 17? Not yet.
You would need an Enrage as well, right?
Yeah, he needs something.
Ooh.
That does nothing. Oh, man, it's so bad. You might actually win with it. No. Did he kill Big Hunter here? It feels so bad. You lose the...
So do you lose to Savage Roar? Because that's the key, isn't it? Because you lose to combo regardless.
Yeah.
So if you don't lose, so it'll be 5. Yeah, I think you have to kill it, because if you armor up, you're not dead to just Savage Roar.
But the problem is you can't win.
Like, I don't think he can win anyway. I think that's the issue.
He'd need to get like Shield Block, get the Shield Block into Death Bite.
And a lot of the patrons
and
have running double
up
Shield
with
Block.
Grommash. Yeah, I know, but I'm saying in order to win, he'd need like exactly.
Yeah.
And even that might
shield
not.
Shield Block into Shield Block into Grommash. What about
or Death Bite,
at least our Seeker into map into Golden Monkey into.
I like that. That'll work. You at least Star Seeker, your Whirlwind, you get the map with Battle Rage afterwards, and then.
There's a swipe that might be enough, actually.
9, 10, 11.
Yeah, that's enough. Nessmath, and Ness will take it over Freaky, which means that Freaky actually got beat by a local.
Yeah, and
hey, UK players, man.
Look what he's using. He's using the most Jedi card in the game.
What's that?
Force of nature.
Yep, indeed.
So pretty impressive, pretty impressive. This is obviously not over for Freaky. This is, I don't know which game it is in the group, but he still has a chance. It's round robin, so everybody plays with everybody.
Right.
And even if you go 1-2, you can supposedly still make it if there's a three-way tie.
Right. If everybody really messed up and one guy just dominated everything, then there's a chance that you have to fight off the three-way tie with everybody else who has a bad score.
Yeah. And RDU is trying to do that exactly.
Yeah, he calculated all his outs, and things have to go really wrong for everybody else. It's a far shot. Like, it's a really long shot.
It's still possible. But that was a pretty cool series, and I'm happy that we've seen Rogue being so good and so dominant. But even though Rogue was so good, still, Ness took the series.
Yeah, really good performance. I think good play from both players. But for me, it's good to see like a qualifier as well take down a player like Freak. He's huge. And, you know.
Right. Well, that's what we were talking about, right? These events where you have, you know, a portion of invites and a portion of people who have to qualify, you're bound to see some recurring faces, even in the qualifier, people who you know are already kind of exist on the tournament scene. But once in a while, you'll get a new name, and that freshens things up. And I think in Hearthstone, with the amount, like, we have a very diverse metagame, which means it's not necessarily as predictable, which means that these, you know, up-and-comers have an even higher chance of having that surprise factor, because the edges are getting slimmer and slimmer as time passes, and that's really fun to watch, so. Congratulations to Ness.
I also like the fact that Ness actually played those complicated decks, the most mid-range, instead of just cheesing with aggros.
Are you saying aggro is cheese?
It is kind
of. Aggro isn't hard to play?
I think like a lot of people expect. Okay, so aggro is actually hard to play, but a lot of people are expecting those new players, new faces, to play the cheese decks. Just go face and win versus those pro players. When they can't do anything.
Right.
But then Ness actually brought complicated decks into complicated matchups, and he succeeded with them.
Yeah, that's right. Actually, that's a great point. I never really thought about it that way, but it is true that most new players tend to bring more of the aggressive lineups.
Yeah.
So that being said, guys, we will be going on a break. We'll be back after it to keep going with the Insomnia True Summer Championship. Stay tuned. Do not go anywhere.